Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
Addressing our every need. And Father, as we come to you now, I just pray, Lord, that you guide and direct this board as we attend to the business of those we serve. In your name I pray. Amen. Amen. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, we have one public speaker that signed up for today, Mr. Tony Cox. Welcome, sir.
Time starts. Can I have just a second to give these out?
Yes, sir, you may.
Thank you.
Thank you.
One of the greatest books that was ever written.
I think it's probably the greatest. Got some good news today. December the 26th, 1960, my mama's brother, 13 years old, fell through the ice and drowned at Glencoe. I hear that they're going to get a plaque or something up there. Appreciate that. Mm-hmm. This jail over here with all that black mold in it, tear it down. I believe it'll be full. I've seen little jobs before that ended up being thousands and thousands of dollars over black mold. Fix it. Tear it down. Contract. Mr. Engel, did you know you were a party to this? Settlement agreement. Contract. That means no statute of limitations, right? Right there it says contract. Deborah Ann Prince, Tony O. Cox, hereafter petitioners, enter this contract settlement agreement. They talk of motions, but they wouldn't know constitutional rights. It also says that this settlement agreement becomes binding on the parties hereto only when signed by all named parties. It's dated the 29th day of October 2007. I don't have the one that's got the commissioners on it. It's all notarized and stuff. This document right here proves the fraud. I've asked for years to let's redress this and let's fix it. But I'm not given a choice. A lot of stuff has happened over them years. Here my life was going good, real good, and then the government wants to jump on me. Not just this one, the DOJ. That's why I can stand here and call them liars, cheats, thieves, wannabe thugs, and cowards, the DOJ. People don't want to take me to court no more, but all these things happen. I really would like to settle this, and I've said it many times before, admission of wrongdoing, that was done when the ordinance was rescinded. And during those special subcommittees and all, there was admission of wrongdoing in the adoption and enforcement of the ordinance law. You just don't do that to people. You just don't do it. A lot of people, because of things that's happened between them and their government, have done bad things. I refuse to do them.
Thank you, Mr. Cox. All right, any commissioner's responses? Okay, do I have a motion on the approval of the agenda for today?
So move.
Second?
Second.
This is the agenda.
Okay. The agenda.
Mr. Chairman, if I could.
Yes, sir.
We have some additional work to do with respect to the performance-based budgeting at this point, and we'd like to have that tabled at this time and brought up at our next meeting.
Item D and the consent agenda.
Yes.
So that will be a change in the full agenda also.
Yes,
once you've changed that.
Yes, sir.
Okay, yeah, we were talking about the agenda. We do have a motion and a second on the agenda. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Consent agenda, we have a request from our county manager that we pull item D from the consent agenda, and we'll address that, I guess, at a later date. And I'm glad you did that. That's a lot of money to be in the consent agenda. I think we need to have a public discussion on that.
Yes, sir.
So it needs to be out in the regular agenda. So with that being said, any other items that members would like pulled from the consent agenda? All right, hearing none, then I have a motion that we approve the consent agenda as amended with the omission of item D.
Motion to approve.
All right, do I hear a second?
Second.
Second. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Okay, next we have item 7, a public hearing. Mr. Honeycutt.
I'm going to turn this over to our planning director, Lee Hodges.
Good morning.
Good morning.
We are requesting to set a public hearing to hear, to provide public feedback for changes to the manufactured home park ordinance. We've revised it and have full approval of the planning board.
Okay.
And we would like to set that for next, the 19th, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. The next commissioner, the next evening commissioner's meeting.
Commissioner's meeting.
Yeah, 16th.
16th at 7 p.m. Any opposition to that?
Mm-hmm.
So we will do so. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, moving right along, item number 8-1, naloxone resolution for EMS, Chuck Mancellus, Director of EMS. Welcome, sir. Did I pronounce that correctly?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Commissioners, you have before you a resolution on an initiative throughout Alamance County to arm tongue-in-cheek with Narcan, which is a opiate antagonist. The thought is to put Narcan in the hands of law enforcement who are routinely out on patrol and may come upon a patient who has experienced an overdose. We have several of the law enforcement agencies throughout the county on board with us. EMS will actually train the law enforcement officers to administer the Narcan, and then we will replace their Narcan if they actually use it in the field. Having the audience with us today, Chief Smythe from Burlington Police Department, and also Karen Webb, who is the project director for the Alamance Citizens for a Drug-Free Community. We think it's a great plan. We encourage all law enforcement agencies in the county to come on board with us, and we need your support as well, and that will begin here. Do you have any questions?
Questions?
I don't see any downside to this. Are there any downsides?
No, sir.
And I think our attorney said it's available over-counter now.
It is, and the state has passed a law granting immunity for all personnel administered.
So that's really what we're pushing to get.
Yes, sir.
Immunity for you guys. So
yes,
when
sir.
You administer, or when chief here, his
well,
guys.
The good thing about it is, if an officer feels that there's been an overdose and they administered Narcan and it's in fact not an overdose, then there's no harm.
That's okay.
What is the civil liability, Mr. Albright, in this, in terms of law enforcement officers administered?
The state of North Carolina passed a law granting immunity specifically for administration of naloxone. And this creates a memorandum of agreement so our EMS department can train them in proper use of it.
I think that's good.
And the sheriff's been involved in these discussions?
I've talked to the sheriff about it. He said that EMS usually gets there before his people do, and he'd rather the EMS use it. I've also spoken to Chief Parker at Elon. He's very interested in it, getting his people.
Other counties have it, don't they, Chuck?
Yes, sir. We are actually modeling our program after the program that's been adopted in Orange County. So, yes, other agencies do participate in this.
What is the cost on replacement of the dosage units?
The actual Narcan itself is, last check was $46 an ampule, and then the atomizers, I think, about $1.50 each.
What is the frequency of use by other agencies? Have we done a study on that?
No, we haven't. I would have to check on that and try to get some information together and bring that back to you.
Okay. I'd like to just know that, see that, what we're, you know, in terms of what we're looking at, in terms of the amount of money to be spent in this program. I think we need to know that. I really do. Any other comments from the commissioners?
But you're already able to do this if you go on site, so it's
yes, sir. The paramedics are trained, and it is part of their protocol to administer this anytime there is a suspected overdose of any type. It's actually a standard protocol that anyone who has a reduced level of consciousness is administered Narcan, just in case.
Preventive measure.
So, yes, sir.
Okay. Any further discussion? I'll entertain a motion at this time.
I'll move that we adopt the resolution and the memorandum of understanding as presented.
Second that.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Chuck,
yes, sir.
One thing before you. How many trucks do you have going now? Is it eight?
Eight, yes, sir.
That's 24/7?
Yes, sir.
And you've only, we added the eighth one a year or two ago.
Last year, yes, sir.
Last year. How is it, has it eased your...
It has eased our burden, but I'll be the first to tell you there is a statewide shortage in paramedics. As a matter of fact, I've had some conversations with the HR director, Ms. Hook, and been out on the website, state website, recently looking, and out of 100 counties, there are 50 other counties who are looking for paramedics at this time. So Alamance will be the 51st county that's looking for paramedics.
Is the community college, are they getting applicants?
The community college does get students into their program, but it's a very rigorous program, and I can't quote you the numbers on what their graduation rate is, but it's a tough program. They may start out with 30 and have 8 to 10 graduate, and of course you've got 50 other counties trying to draw from that pool, and
Well, I know at one time I think the hospital wanted us to have about 12 trucks 24/7.
It's been some time, yes, sir.
And let me get around to it. Do you need more trucks now if you had the personnel to...
If we had the personnel, yes, we could use additional trucks. But, you know, during the daytime we have two BLS trucks available that can also respond as a backup to ALS calls. So during the week, I'm not going to say we're golden, but we have more coverage, but at nights and on the weekends, and that sometimes does become a burden. We're routinely having to call in other counties, our surrounding counties, for mutual aid, and we also depend upon the Alamance Rescue to come in and staff their truck as well.
What's your response time then?
I think average response time is a little over 9 minutes now. Last time I checked, those numbers is a little over 9 minutes.
Thanks, Chuck.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
I just want to mention, last meeting we approved the franchise, I guess you call it, for the home health.
Yes, sir.
I mean, that should relieve a little bit.
What that is for specialty care transports out of Alamance Regional going back to Cone Hospital. So, yes, that would...
But if they weren't doing that, you'd be...
We would be responsible. Yes, sir.
Yeah. All right.
And that, you know, go back to something Chuck said. If remember the board, we approved an additional $50,000 for rescue, and they're supposed to have on staff 7 days a week from 8 to 5 two paid full-time positions, so that does surface that back up.
All right. Any further? Thank you, Chuck.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Okay. Next we have Mr. Honeycutt, update on the countywide strategic plan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'll have Ms. Hodges as well and Commissioner Byrd be a part of this conversation. As the board's aware, we had our initial visioning discussion at ARMC on September 11th. It was a half-day retreat, and it went well, I thought. Very good input from staff, very good input from the board. And now we're looking at next steps, and kind of the direction that was given by the board at that time was to come up with a work plan, come up with a timeline, come up with a budget to move forward for implementation. And I do want to thank the work that Libby and Jessica has done. She's our new planner, and Commissioner Byrd, we've met numerous times with the School of Government, Lydia and Altman. And so we're at the point now, we wanted to present you the work plan, the process, and how we would suggest moving forward. So with that said, I'll turn it over to Libby.
Thank you.
I just want to double check. When I printed my agenda off this morning, it looked a little strange. Is that what is showing up on all of yours, or is it readable?
Mine's readable.
Okay. All right, just making sure, because...
Yeah, mine's readable.
Good morning.
Morning.
I'm here this morning to give you an update on the strategic plan process. As a short review, maybe not. Go to the next slide.
Moving right along.
Just to go over kind of what we've done is we've taken another look at the Destination 2020 review, and we've held our visioning retreat. We spent a lot of time at the visioning retreat talking about the value of a strategic plan and how we would use that. I think at the retreat we also saw the value of an excellent facilitator, somebody to keep us on track, somebody to ask good questions and help us frame the answers in a way that we can use to move forward. Go to the next slide. This is a brief overview of the retreat objectives. So we went over the 2020 review. We also were able to take our responses and generally set them as short, medium, and long-term goals or visions that we have for the county. And the summary should be included in your agenda packet. The two big parts that we really are focusing on moving forward with the work plan are going to be the establishment of the preliminary vision for the community, as well as determining the expectations for the strategic planning process, because we really needed to know where we wanted to go before we can set up a plan to go forward. Next slide. One of the other major items that we talked about is our role as the government in leading this process. So at the top is our responsibility to move this process forward. I would also like to draw attention to two of the other items, which is to represent public views, which a lot of this strategic plan is about going out and finding out what it is our citizens want us to do and making sure that what we're doing is aligning with that. Seeking the guidance of experts when needed and allocating resources to create the plan and to move the plan forward. So our next steps from here, the work plan should be included in your agenda. I think there's a copy of it as well that you have. Do you have a PDF? Okay. But what we're seeking approval at this time to do is to engage the School of Government to begin drafting our initial questions for a couple of polls that are on the work plan so that we can frame our community input sessions from there. To approve the funding. He's going to give you a view of the work plan here. Hopefully it comes up in your packet just a little more clearly. But we're looking between $15,000 and $20,000 to get the plan started from here.
And again, one of the things, and there is cost that is associated with this, but one of the things we have really strived, and I think is why it's taken us a while since September, is to identify where we as staff can get involved and keep that cost down. And just in comparison, the city of Burlington recently completed their strategic plan, and it was $73,500.
We don't
want to do that. So I'll add that. I mean, this is even $75,000 is low to really do a thorough plan in my experience.
Right.
But I think what Libby and the staff have done is to put together a planning process that utilizes our own staff to about as full as we can possibly do in conducting a lot of these community input sessions. We're only using the services of Lydia and out of the School of Government very sparsely. That's
yeah.
a good term for
and
it. Yeah,
we're trying to involve the Elon University, some internships. We're trying to involve the School of Government and UNC with some internships. So if there is costs associated, we would have those low-cost people working and not the high-cost School of Government all the time.
You know, when you look at people ask, well, why do you want a plan? And part of the exercise that we did at the retreat was to identify what's coming at us in the future. What do we need to be thinking about as we do plan? And we identified things like we're going to need new schools in the future. And I was at a school board meeting last week, and that was pretty evident. you look at the demographic changes in our community, and we have more and more people of different ethnicities coming and living with us, and what do we need to be doing as a county government to help in that issue? That was one. I think there was a bullet point on your slide presentation about, well, one thing that we can do is make sure our own hiring practices, we're employing good, getting good diverse workforce. Land use and protecting farmland is a big issue that we're going to need to plan for. You know, economic development. So there's lots of things that are happening in our external environment that really we need to be able to anticipate and be able to deal with those issues. So the plan will help us allocate those resources and prioritize resources.
And one thing we talked about as well is one of the most important things I think this will help with is everybody needs to go through the process every now and then to check back in with the community, to check back in with the board, to check back in with the municipality. So really, the process is almost as valuable as the outcomes that will be, because we will be seeking a lot of input from a lot of different people.
Well, as you look at what's going on in the county now in terms of growth, you know, if you continue to shoot from the hip, well, you know, which I like to use instead of having a plan for the future, it can be troublesome. I talked with a commissioner in Johnson County, and they've had significant growth. It's coming from the triangle to the east. Well, guess what we're seeing? We're seeing significant growth coming from the east to us. So they're going from the west to the east, the triangle there to Johnson County. And, you know, there's people that said over the years there's similarities when you look at Alamance and Johnson. So lo and behold, their population now is about 200,000. It has grown that much. In the last 6 years, I think they've built four schools. They've had to because of the overpopulation. And as these things continue to creep up on us, if we don't have a plan, it could be some serious problems. So
we have our own facilities issues.
That's not counting what we see here. Our friend Tony Cox brought up something about mold in the buildings. Right. I mean, is that something that we need to address in the future?
We can't expect to work in that environment.
No. We need to, you know, we need a plan. We really do in this time, and I think all of you that's been working on this for what you've done. Any further comments?
One thing I'd like to add to Dan's comment about we're soon to come from the east, actually we're in a perfect location. Yeah. A lot of the people I talk to about moving here, yeah, they actually like it because maybe one of them works in Greensboro that way, somebody works towards Research Triangle. Guess what? We're right in the middle, and it kind of cuts down for and helps marriages last longer, so one doesn't have to ride from one to the other, okay? And also, if you look up and down our highways, all of the apartments that are being built, they are not building those expecting them to sit empty. There will be real live people living in those, a lot of them within the next year, and we're actually a little bit behind the eight ball in figuring what's coming, because there's been over the years a little bit of lack of all the municipalities working together. We're the county. We encompass all these municipalities. You got Graham, you got Burlington Building Apartments, Elon, and I think we need to be the center of this hub of what we're doing here to get a better picture for our educators and everybody else to know who's coming, what's happening, and that type of thing. And I appreciate what you've done in that so far.
Yeah. And, you know, one of the other things that hadn't even been discussed, I mean, once the brick and mortar's dried, we've got between 1,600 and 2,000 more jobs coming to this county. Well, what's that going to mean in terms of housing, the number of houses being built? Certainly, my good friend Sammy Moser, we talked about the fact, well, a lot of these jobs may be coming from outside the county, and certainly, and Sammy's right in that respect. But even in saying that, a lot of them's going to be folks who are going to be living here. And, you know, things like, you know, this board and our staff need to be on top of things like Well, these folks are receiving these incentives. Are they doing what they say they're going to do in terms of salaries? And, when you have a company that says, well, our average pay will be 40-something thousand, and then they're advertising in the paper at part-time help for $10 an hour, that may be full-time. So, we just need to stay on top of them and make sure they're right. But that's just a sidebar. The bottom line is we're growing. We're growing, and we need to be prepared. That's the bottom line.
Well, the deal is, in my opinion, I can't see spending any money on this issue. A future board is not bound by anything this board does. And I remember a 2020 plan coming in, whenever it was, 2000, and I can't remember hearing the 2020 plan even mentioned in the last 10, 12 years at the most, at the least. So I don't have any problem with staff working on this sort of thing, and I guess it can be a guide, but come next November, the board could change again, and probably will, and that new board is not bound by anything that this board passes concerning a strategic plan for the future.
Well, in terms of the changing of the board, that's to be determined by the voters of this county, and I have great faith in the voters, so I don't, Judge, I disagree with you on the changing of the board. I think the jury's still out on that. And I think when you look at $15,000, I don't think that's an extravagant amount when you're talking about the staff has already saved a great deal of money. And it seems like I remember a previous board had paid $50,000 for a pay study. That it really didn't make sense to me that if you're going to pay for the pay study, then why don't you use it? And and you're right, one board can't be held accountable for a future board. I concur with that. They're not.
And I'm going to have to disagree with David too, because I've been to that 2020 plan a few times just to see what was the thought process, because that plan was developed and it cost money to go around to all the schools. I went to a lot of those meetings. I know Mr. Mosier was a number of them, and people had input. The community felt like they had a buy-in to how their county looks 10 years down the road, another 5 years, 2020, okay. So they felt like they had a buy-in to that. Now, did the boards do exactly what they wanted? No. But at least it gives the staff and everybody that works in government here for the county every day an opportunity to at least think about what do people want? What do people in our community want? And I think that's the biggest part of this whole thing, is to get the community involved into what we're going to do here. And whether the next board chooses to throw it in the garbage can or not, that's their decision.
That's right.
So I'm with Dan on that one.
As long as I'm on the board, I'm going to try to do my part to make sure it's in front of us and the staff every month, and hold everybody accountable to achieving the goals that are in the plan.
City of Burlington, they change city council. They may change it tomorrow. They may have a total different board, but they have a set guideline of where the city wants to go, and that was the community at large had a buy-in to that.
And certainly that can always change from board to board. It can. All right, any further comments? All right.
Well, being the commissioner's representative in this process, I'll make the motion that we authorize up to $20,000 to be spent on this planning process. I guess that comes out of the general fund.
Yes, sir. Do I have a second?
I'll second that.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Next, we have budget amendments. General Schools Capital Reserve Finance Officer. Morning, Susan.
Morning. Before you, I'm bringing a budget amendment. It's something that we have not been able to do in past years, but we are this year. State general statute says that once Articles 40 and 42 come in that exceed the debt service for the year, that those proceeds be set aside in a capital reserve fund. So I'm asking for us to be able to transfer $278,907.43 from the general fund to the school's capital reserve fund, which they can use for capital projects in the future.
Right. Questions?
And Mr. Chairman, just to remember, we in the past, since those articles have not been fully funded, the debt service has not been fully funded, we have used lottery funds to help pay for debt service. Right. But now, since the sales tax has greatly increased, it is exceeding what we thought in our debt service, that money does go to school capital improvement.
Right.
That's needed.
Further right. Questions?
Yeah, that was 278?
278, yes.
Hearing no further questions, I'll entertain a motion.
Motion to approve.
All right. I hear a second.
Second.
All right. Thank you, Judge. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. We have also a budget amendment from the Sheriff's Office. Sheldon Brown. Welcome, sir.
Yes, sir. Good morning, all of you.
Good morning.
The sheriff sends his best. He's at a sheriff's convention out of town. He wanted me to come over. The total add to the SCAP funds was $22,572. In the account 4320-601, he would like to transfer $4,062.96 from 4320-601 to 4320-190 to pay Robert Stegall for filling out the application for the SCAP.
All right. Any questions? Comments? Do I hear a motion?
Motion to approve.
Right, motion. Thank you. Motion is second. Those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next, we have a county manager with a budget amendment.
Yes, sir. Thank you. In working with ACTA, they recently received a grant to change over their vehicles from gas to natural gas. And the grant is for $110,255.50. This will be a reimbursement. We basically be fronting them the money because they will have to send invoices in. So they have a cash flow issue, so they've asked that we front them the money. And as soon as the grant pays them back, it'll come straight back to us. And that should be done within 90 days.
What kind of grant is it that they're applying for?
I think it's with the state.
It's a state grant,
and looking at environmentally clean buses, right. Again, going natural gas.
Rebate from Duke Energy or
we're going to
no coal ash involved.
Just if I could just say, I'm on their board, and they will save a lot of money in fuel expenses as a result of converting these to natural gas, as well as it's better environmentally.
Yeah.
So they just have to spend the money first. Send it to the state to apply for it, and then they'll get reimbursed, and then they'll pay the county
back. Right. So that should be done within 90 days.
So it's basically a short-term loan.
It's a short-term cash flow loan. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
All right, any further comments or questions? I'll entertain the motion that we approve. Do I have a second?
Second.
All right. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Ms. Roberts, financial update.
Good morning again. All right, I'm bringing before you the first quarter's financial update. There we go. Yeah. Okay. Comparing fiscal year 2014-15 to fiscal year 15-16, you can see where we had an adopted budget of $130 million compared to $137 for fiscal year 16. Percent change year-to-date due to amendments has been 0.80%. Our revenues, we have collected 43% of our budget compared to 40% at this time last year. An overall increase in revenues of 13%. The biggest majority of that is coming from our property tax increase that we've received 14.6% increase in property taxes. Our expenditures of budget, we are comparable to exactly where we were at this point in time last year, 24% to 25% expended. And our revenues over expenditures, last fiscal year we were at 18.8 million. This fiscal year we're at 22.6, other financing sources, which comes from the sale of surplus property. Last fiscal year at this time, we were at $904. This year, we're at $75. Net effect is $18.8 million for last year, and where we're at this year is $22.6 million. I'll entertain any questions.
The net effect, that's the fund balance?
That's what we're ahead of expenditure of revenues over expenditures right now.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So we get that influx during the first July and August, and then we'll see another influx in December, and those will offset all of our expenditures through the year.
All right. Any further questions?
Your anticipation on the impact on the fund balance? If we keep going like we are for this
for
year?
Last previous year, I feel like we're right on track to add at least $5 million to fund balance.
Which will bring it to what percentage?
Pardon?
What would be the percentage?
That I don't have yet. The auditors are finalizing our audit because that number is based on our total expenditures, and we don't have all of our accruals into our figures yet.
But we know what we have budgeted for total expenditures.
Yes.
So if everything went according to budget, what would be?
Yeah. But our expenses luckily have been below budget, so we can get you. I can get you an estimate of that percentage.
And we should have the audit presented in December.
In December, yes.
So it, it's kind of the normal time frame for the audit is.
I know this is kind of out of sequence, but has the audit group that we've been using, have you been pleased with their services?
Yes, sir. And they are very knowledgeable when it comes to governmental financing and governmental funds and accounting. They do a extensive job every year and keep us on our toes.
I know one of the things we passed in our consent today was requests for proposals, but
yes, we've been very pleased, but there had been some concern expressed by the board to put that out to bid. Right. So we were just doing that as a
and
pleasure
to the board. Right. Practice.
I think it's a good practice.
Yeah. Yes.
I think the last time we changed auditors was about 4 years ago.
It was for fiscal year 2011.
Right. So, and again, the board, I think two or three months ago, mentioned that that was a concern. So, and I appreciate Susan and her staff going ahead and getting that ready. So, we'll have it ready for you before time next year.
Right.
You know, one thing we could think about, what we took off the consent agenda today regarding incentive pay and the whole performance management program is, if we're running behind or lower on our expenses than what we had budgeted, and that's due to the work of our staff, I expect, by and large. And you know, and I think that in my view, we need to have a goal of increasing our fund balance to that 25-26% range of operating expenses, and seems like this is helping to do that.
It's pushing it.
It's pushing it, yeah.
It is.
Okay. Further comments? Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. All right, next we have the county manager's report.
I did want to go out publicly, since the discussion of our jail roof did come up, we have had conversations, and first I'd like to thank Richard Hill, our jail staff, Brian Haygood, our county attorney, Clyde Albright. We have been very diligent in working with our roof engineer. We have been very diligent about working with a supplier. We've been very diligent about working with the roofer that they will remove the roof and start over. So it should have never gotten to this point. They've acknowledged. And we did testing, there was issues, so we're in the process that they will remove the existing roof that they put in new and replace. So, and it will be all done under the guidelines of the supplier, because there's the ones that will have to give the warranty for the roof.
Do we have a figure on the amount of water damage?
We're keeping up with that. I don't know if there's a total figure at this point, Shelton, do you? But we are keeping up that, you know, we had cost of moving people to Castle County. We've had jail costs. We've had roof costs. We've had sheriff's desk problems, sheriff's desk carpet. So we are keeping up with all those costs as well.
We've also put the insurance company on notice that we expect the place to be cleaned, the ducts to be cleaned, and I be kept on any kind of mold issues. Since
right.
We have about 400 involuntary guests over there, and we're going to ensure the air quality is free of any kind of mold.
Isn't there a responsibility also in terms of liability if there's mold in the future?
Yes, and, they have a general liability policy. I think their company's on notice. We're going to get somebody in there to abate it. The contractor's aware of this too.
Yeah.
Cleaned it up the first time. Mm. They've been very quick to get water up, but we don't want a roof with water under it.
Right.
That's why they're tearing it off and redoing it.
Yeah.
And by the way, we haven't paid
them
anything.
That's right. Any further questions?
That mold issue can definitely be an issue that we have to address.
Yes.
Does the county carry a rider on our insurance to, because I was just in a class last week and they were talking about how to keep water out of your houses. And, you know, but you can buy a rider as a builder to help cover that on your general liability and stuff, but
we have a $5 million umbrella policy.
Okay. But mold's not excluded because
well,
some
I'll go
policies
I'll
exclude
make sure that.
That
it's in there. It's not with you.
Right.
I believe we're covered for that.
Okay.
But what we're going to do in this case, we're going to make their insurance primary.
Gotcha. And their cap on their general liability is
$2 million.
But that's all I have right now.
Oh, yeah?
Yes, sir.
Okay, commissioner's comments. Anybody like to start?
Just a reminder, when is ACC's breakfast? I don't want to miss that.
It is December. I'm sorry, let me pull my calendar up. It's the first Wednesday.
December 2nd.
December 2nd. Okay.
At 7:30.
Okay. Sure about that one.
Right. See, I beat him. He was pulling up on his computer. I had it right here. It still works. The old one still works. Any further comments?
Well, I'd just like to say, I mentioned earlier that I was at the Board of Education meeting last week, and the subject of proposed redistricting of the elementary schools was discussed, and it was on the agenda, and so people showed up in mass from the Mevin community.
Like a lead balloon, did
but there, out of that discussion, there is a lot of eyes being turned toward the commissioners about some perceived lack of funding for our school system, and just, you know, the support of our schools in general, and this group thinks that there needs to be an additional elementary school in the Mebane area to take care of the growth. I've got full confidence in Dr. Harrison and his staff to figure out exactly what's best, how to redistribute students if needed, before recommending any new schools. But I just wanted to just bring it up because it is an issue that's being talked about out in the community that we should be aware of.
Isn't there a facilities meeting this week also?
Yes,
Tammy, sir.
No, he's on that committee. So.
I'm still slow with the computer.
Yeah,
it is
9 a.m. Thursday, I believe it was. Yes.
Yes.
Sammy, you beat me.
I'm 0 for 2.
All right, any further comments or questions? Hearing none, meeting adjourned.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m. and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the commissioners' meetings may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.